Zondervan presents Living with Questions by Dale Fincher, read by the author.
To my mother, Lois Ann Fincher, whose life taught me to live with questions. Live the questions now. Perhaps then, someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer. Rainer Maria Rilke, Letters to a Young Poet.
Preface, A Tale of Two Friends. CJ lived next door to Max since the fifth grade. In those early days, the whole world seemed to lie right outside their front doors. They'd ride their bikes to the grocery store to buy baseball cards. On weekends, they'd sleep at each other's houses and build forts by draping sheets across their bedrooms. They played video games when Home Run Derby in the street got rained out. And as they grew into their teenage years, the games didn't change. They only got more complicated. When the pair pulled CJ's silver Cadillac into a parking lot by the beach, a parking attendant from the nearby restaurant shouted, "Get Daddy's car off my lot!" Max waved his arms out the passenger window and shouted back, "This isn't his dad's car, it's his!" CJ screeched the tires as they bumped over the curb and headed back into traffic. Driving the caddy embarrassed CJ, even though he was the first one of his friends to have wheels. So to make up for not having a sports car, he'd rev the engine in neutral, then kick it into drive to make the tires squeal. CJ received his mom's hand-me-down vehicle when he was 16, the day after the dentist removed his braces, in fact. The car even came with cloth seats and imitation wood trim, the complete package. CJ used his Christmas and birthday money to rig the car with subwoofers in the trunk. It thumped down the street so loudly that Max nicknamed it the Trunk of Funk. On the weekends, CJ and Max spent a lot of time with Steven and their other friends just leaning against the hood of the Cadillac in the parking lot of Taco Bell. "What are you guys doing?" kids would ask as they pulled up. "Nothing," the usual reply. If they'd been doing something, they wouldn't be standing in a parking lot. But it was a good place to plan, hang with the people, and meet girls. CJ grew up with his mom and younger sister. His father moved out when CJ was 6. His sister pestered him endlessly at home, always annoying him from his bedroom doorway until he got angry enough to knuckle her on the arm. Then she'd tell their mom, and that usually earned CJ a reprimand. Worse than home, though, were CJ's weekend visits with his dad every couple of months. When he went to his father's place in the country, he felt stuffed inside an alien world. CJ just wanted to hang with his friends back in his neighborhood, not feel trapped with grown-ups. CJ liked Max, because he was one of the few friends who didn't insult CJ when other guys were around. Max also didn't compete with CJ or try to prove he was better than him, unlike many of CJ's other friends. They didn't even compete with each other in sports. CJ was the basketball player and Max was the football player. They saw the world in the same way, too, which made CJ trust Max even more. And when it came to laughing, they generated enough inside jokes and sayings to make a recording on an old cassette tape. They were equals, blood brothers for life. Though CJ attended a Christian school, he spent little time with his classmates off campus. His neighborhood friends were far more interesting. They grew up together through elementary, middle, and now high school. His friends attended public school, and they came home with stories that sounded like headlines from a newspaper. "Did you hear about Steven? He got so drunk on Friday that he was puking in the back seat of Ashley's car." They all laugh about it together. CJ wondered what it would be like to get drunk, and he wondered if Ashley was laughing too. One day, before the Trunk of Funk era, Max took CJ to his dad's bedroom closet. Inside were piles of pornographic magazines, stacked in rows that towered above their heads. There were more magazines than clothes. Something deep in CJ's gut rebelled. "This isn't right," he thought to himself. "But Max's dad thinks it's fine. And Max's dad is a war veteran, a strong guy, and he still lives in Max's house. Do these pictures bother Max? Why are we sneaking around? What if we are caught? Is that the front door opening and closing? Max had better hurry up anyway." Max navigated the closet as though he'd done it before. He pulled down a magazine and thumbed through the pages. At that moment, CJ knew he was the only sheltered person standing in the closet. Max is all right, CJ thought. He sticks with me, but my stomach aches. I shouldn't look at this stuff. But I'm curious. Just a little curious. It won't hurt me to just look. They took a few of the magazines and put them in Max's closet. 2 months later, CJ turned 15. Through those years, CJ and Max savored the more complicated pleasures of their self-made world. They listened to rap music from a ghetto-oppressed African-American culture they pictured in their heads. They enjoyed military-themed movies and hitting mailboxes with baseball bats. They loved the idea of civil rebellion and hatred of the police, although they never attended a protest and rarely encountered the authorities. At home, CJ grew persistently more rude and argumentative toward his mother and sister. His mind moved with belligerence and anger. His best weapon was his sharp and deprecating tongue. His mother disapproved of his music, mysterious capers, and friends, but she rarely made demands besides going to church on Sunday, eating dinner together each weeknight, and a midnight curfew on the weekends. When Halloween came, CJ's mother asked him to take his sister to a Halloween alternative party at their church. "Mom, come on, that's boring. I don't want to do that," he exclaimed. His mother consented under his onslaught of words. CJ, now alone in the house, met Max at the front door before sunset. "Do you have the bottles?" Max asked. CJ grinned. He filled them that afternoon with the acid used to balance the chemicals in the swimming pool. Stuffing the bottles into the cargo pockets of their camouflage fatigues, CJ and Max strolled into the dusky streets. A white van tore around the corner and stopped in the middle of the street beside a black sports car. From the car window came obscene gestures, and then the guys in the van threw raw eggs at the car. Max knew the guys in the van, including the driver, Jason. Max introduced them to CJ, and then he and CJ climbed aboard. The van circled the block and stopped in a new neighborhood. The guy slammed open the van doors and rushed a group of trick-or-treating children, including an unsuspecting Cinderella and her brother, the Pumpkin. Max fisted two eggs. CJ grabbed one. Not wanting to hurt the youngsters, CJ lagged behind just enough to be harmless, yet appear malicious. A sprint through a field, some squeals, a few dropped bags of candy were enough to please these guys. They returned to the waiting van and cruised into another subdivision. Max shared the secret about what he and CJ were carrying in their cargo pockets. "What an idea!" Jason exclaimed. CJ played along. So the six of them crawled out of the parked van. Darting under shadows, they clustered under a hedgerow across the street from their target. "Do you know this house?" asked CJ. "No," said the boys. Max pulled out his acid bottle. They mixed the chemicals to create a reaction. Then one guy bolted across the street, opened the mailbox, and shoved the bottle inside before hurrying back. The boys huddled together under a bush and held their breath. The bomb's explosion pierced the night, and it was soon followed by the sound of car alarm sirens and the glare of porch lights as the neighbors investigated the noise. The grass hardly bent under CJ's speedy feet, and nobody dared to glance back. They regrouped at the van, no adults sighted. As the evening waned, the neighborhood children went indoors. It was a school night, time to go home. The streets settled. They would first drop off CJ and Max. They drove through Holly Field and turned down Fawn Lane. Then they took a left onto Mulberry. A flashing blue light suddenly tailed them. They all cursed. CJ took his extra bottle of acid and threw it deep under the seats. His mind raced for alternative stories to the mailbox explosion. "If I play it politely and respectfully," he thought, "maybe I could dodge the trouble." The van pulled to the curb and the boys piled out. Two police cars stopped behind the van with their flashing lights reflecting off the nearby windows where neighbors watched. "This white van has been reported for vandalizing with eggs," said the officer. "Some people threw eggs at us, too," Jason exclaimed as he took a step toward the cop. Without flinching, the officer continued, "I want you to dump all the eggs into the street." Claiming no ownership to the eggs, CJ backed against the curb and stayed behind the boys as they emptied the cartons onto the pavement. He hoped the officers wouldn't find that bottle of acid under the van seats and trace it back to the mailbox. "Is that all of the eggs?" the officer boomed. They nodded. "Are you sure? If I find any more eggs in this vehicle, you're in serious trouble. Are you certain these are all the eggs?" They nodded again. The mess of white and yellow streamed into the gutter. The officer reached into the car, wrestled through some empty cartons, and pulled out a dozen fresh eggs. The boys groaned. "You can't do this," Jason protested. He moved between the officer and the van. Without hesitation, the officer pushed and then pinned Jason against the hood. "I'm sick of punks like you," he said. "You are under arrest. In fact, because of him, you're all under arrest." CJ froze. For the first time that he could remember, he felt like he was on the wrong side. The officer searched the van with eager flashlights. They found other illegal goods, including weapons and a blue flashing light that impersonated the ones still spinning on the police cars. You know that hopeless feeling you get when there's no way out? How you wish you could just disappear? You wish you could undo the past a couple of hours and delete the trouble you're in now? You wish you had no adventure and that you were safe at a church party or even under the covers in your own bed. That's how CJ felt. He looked at the street sign on the corner, Mulberry Way and Grover Lane. He was only 2 blocks from home. "What does this mean?" he thought. "Are we being handcuffed? Am I going to jail? How do I get out of this? How do I hide this from Mom? Why couldn't the cops have pulled the van over 2 minutes later when I'd be home and away from the trouble? Why is Max's friend being an idiot and yelling at the cops? Why didn't they dump all the eggs?" Then CJ sensed the world slowing down. The police escorted the boys toward the patrol cars one by one. One was handcuffed and pinned against the van. Another recited his address to the policeman. CJ felt alone. Max had failed him. Their favorite rap music with its "F the police" lyrics now sounded small and tinny in CJ's mind. Then the prayer that was waiting in CJ's chest came through. "God, help me." A voice from within returned just as quickly. "Why should I help you? So you can make my name small in the earth?" All escapes were now closed. In those few moments spent watching the officer scribble down his name and watching his friends get shoved into the squad cars, CJ's emotions intensified and he realized something shockingly clear. If there was a purpose to life, this wasn't it. This was not new and improved, sophisticated, helpful, safe, or sane. It was nasty, brutish, and lonely. When CJ finally returned home, his mother scolded him. She blamed herself for not insisting that he go to the party at church. She walked up the street to Max's house and briefly spoke with Max's dad. Then she came home again, discouraged by his hands-off attitude. All the while, she was unaware of the things happening in CJ's soul and the new questions that lived there. A daunting question kept ringing in his mind. How should I live? While he wrestled with that thought, shut inside his room, he discovered other questions that needed to be answered first. Do ideas really matter? Isn't it enough that my friends like me and let me hang with them in the parking lot on weekends? If ideas matter so much, then which ones are the true ideas and how would I know? Does my life need to line up with the truth? How? Does God exist? If so, does God listen? Does he care? These questions all needed answers before CJ could make sense of his first question. CJ then became afraid, more afraid than he'd ever been before, even while he was being arrested on the street. I feel thrown into existence, CJ thought, and I don't know why. To the center of his soul, it haunted him. He needed some time before he could formulate any answers, so he knocked them around in his head. He began to read for himself. He learned to listen to different voices, not just the voices of his friends or the rap artists. CJ hung out with Max later that week, but it felt different. More weeks passed, CJ holed up in his room a lot where he mostly journaled and explored other kinds of music. Max knocked on the front door after school one day. "Hey, what's up?" CJ asked. "We're going over to Steven's. Want to come?" "No. You guys go ahead. What's wrong with you, man?" Max voiced the same question rumbling in CJ's soul. CJ didn't have an answer. "Nothing. Really," he shrugged. "I just don't feel like going." That was all he could say. "All right. See ya." CJ closed the door and ended an era. He watched through the window as Max stepped off the porch and walked across the driveway. He met up with some other guys, and they all moved slowly up the street. CJ and Max's friendship never recovered. CJ's story isn't unique. Many people have needed their worlds shattered to help them wake up to the real stuff of life. But you don't have to experience a shattered world to start taking life seriously. You have the choice to ask your own questions right now. Look at your life. What is your story? Where are you? What matters most to you? Listen to yourself. What would devastate you if it were removed? Your driving privileges, your friends, your own bedroom, your clothing style, your cell phone, your music, your freedom? Why would it hurt you? Be honest about your fears, pain, and desires for living the way you do. Socrates, the famous Greek philosopher, told us, "The unexamined life is not worth living." Just like CJ, the police eventually arrested Socrates too. They even poisoned him. But unlike CJ, Socrates lived an examined life. And unlike CJ, he discovered some of the stuff of real life that was worth living and dying for. Examine your life and see what comes to mind. Here are some questions to help you begin. What would the ideal life look like for you? What's good about your life? What do you want more than anything else in life? What does it mean to be happy? If you could change one habit in your life, what would it be? What's the one thing you cannot live without? What has hurt you most in life? When you're sad or lonely, who do you turn to? Friends? Music? Reading? Alcohol? Cutting? CJ started living with questions when all the escapes were cut off. But rather than being confined...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.